Amen. All right, we'll be ready. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy, Lord God, your peace, your protection, and your provision. Father God, we just come in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord God, asking that you would have your way, Lord God. We glorify you, Lord God, this morning, and we lift you up. We thank you, Lord God, for all that you're doing, Father God, and we are praying, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, that you would have your way. Allow us, Lord God, to be sensitive unto your voice on this morning, Lord God, that we may receive the instructions, Lord God, that you've already spoken, Lord God, in the heavens, Lord God, to your people, Lord God, on how we should, Father God, respond, Lord God, in times like this, Lord God. We know that, Lord God, you're in control, Lord God, so we ask that you would, Father God, forgive us, Lord God, and we come, Lord God, asking that you would forgive us for our sins, Lord God, our sins of omission, our sins of commission, the lust of the flesh, the lust of the eyes, and even the pride of life, Lord God. Open up our eyes and our ears, Lord God, to receive, Lord God, this morning, a word, Father God, from you, Lord God. And we thank you, Lord God, for those that are present, Lord God, those, Father God, in the name of Jesus Christ, Lord God, that sacrifice, Lord God, to come out, Lord God, to hear a word from you, Lord God. And those, Lord God, that are protecting themselves, Lord God, in the natural, we thank you, Lord God, for them also, Lord God. And we just ask that you have your way. We welcome, Lord God, the power of your Holy Spirit, Lord God, to fill this place, Lord God, that we may hear from you, Lord God, and not man, Lord God. And we'll be careful to give you all the praise, all the honor and glory, for it's in Christ Jesus' name we ask it all and believe. Amen. I want to say good morning to everyone. Thank God for your presence on this morning, and we're going to be obedient, amen, to the Spirit of God this morning. And I want to share with you all that this morning I would like to tell the people of God that we are in a transition. I would like to remind his people of the grace and mercy of God during this time of crisis and rebellion. And we are fully aware of what is going on in our nation and the world. And whether you believe it or not, this is nothing new. It's just new to this generation. We know of the great war that exists. We know of the enemy and his power and his schemes. But today's message is for and to God's people. Amen. So just for a few moments, I would like to shed some light on what many of God's people have forgotten during these times of trauma, during this time of trials and this time of tribulation, and that is our God is a strong deliverer. Amen. Turn with me to the book of Judges, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. We'll be reading from the New King James Version. The book of Judges, chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. And when you find it, please stand in reverence to God's holy word. Amen. And this is the word of God for God's people. And it reads, then the angel of the Lord came up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I led you up from Egypt and brought you to the land of which I swore to your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you. And you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. You shall tear down their altars. But you have not obeyed my voice. Why have you done this? Therefore, I also said, I will not drive them out before you, but they shall be thorns in your side, and their God shall be a snare to you. So it was when the angel of the Lord spoke these words to all the children of Israel that the people lifted up their voices and wept. You may be seated in the presence of the Most Holy God. This morning, for a brief moment, I'll be sharing with you the message that God has given unto me to give unto his people. And he says, this morning, when my people repent, I will send a deliverer. When my people repent, I will send a deliverer. In verse 1 of the book of Judges, chapter 2, it says, then the angel of the Lord came up from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I led you up from Egypt and brought you to the land of which I swore to your fathers. And I said, I will never break my covenant with you. So this morning, I'm asking a question to you all. What did the people of God forget back then that we have forgotten now? Verse 1, it says that the angel of the Lord came upon from Gilgal to Bochim and said, I led you up from Egypt and brought you to the land of which I swore to your fathers.
what we have forgotten now that they forgot back then, that God is our deliverer. The text says that the angel of the Lord told them that, look, I need to put you into remembrance of where you used to be. Remember, you used to be a slave. You used to be oppressed by the enemy. And I am the one that brought you out. This text also tells me in verse 1 that they forgot that God is the one that guided them through the Red Sea and the desert. They forgot that God was not only their deliverer, but they forgot that God was their protector. Once again, he's putting them in remembrance. And he's putting us in remembrance of what God has done for us in our past. Can you see the Israelites fleeing from Egypt and Pharaoh and his army and his soldiers? And as they continue to move forward, they came upon this obstacle called the Red Sea. The man of God, the leader of God, looked at the Red Sea, and the people of God looked back and they saw their enemies, their oppressors coming against them. And they cried out, and the leader of God, the man of God, reached up and prayed up to God and asked God for some help. And God told the man of God, the leader of God, to use what was in his hand. We know that the man of God took that staff and stretched it over the Red Sea. And even in the midst of what was going on, it showed us, even though we know the story, we're familiar with everything that's going on, we see that, we realize that God was their protector. And this is what verse 1 is reminding us, that not he's only our deliverer, but that God is our protector. And the third thing that this scripture, this passage in verse 1 shows us, that it says that not only was he their deliverer, not only was he their protector, but it said that they forgot that God gave them the promised land. In other words, that their God is their provider. Look what it says in verse 1 again. It says, I led you up from Egypt and brought you to the land of which I swore to your father. The people of God have forgotten that God not only made them a deliverer, it was their deliverer, but that their protector, and he also said he was their provider. Don't you know that even though in times that we're in right now, that God is still our deliverer? God is still our protector, and God is still our provider. But just like the people of God in this text, because they disobeyed God and start serving other gods, and because of this, the people of God, they lost some things. God is warning the people today that because you bow down and because you start serving other gods, you when you start serving other gods and you forget about the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you start serving other gods, you start to forget some things. Or they lost some things, they say. What did they lose? Pastor, go to verse 2 and 3 of Judges chapter 2. And look at verse 2 and 3. He says, and you shall make no covenant with the inhabitants of this land. He says, you shall tear down the altars. But you have not obeyed my voice. The angel of the Lord is asking the people of God, why have you done this? Why have you failed to do exactly what I've commanded you to do? Then he says in verse 3, therefore I also said, I will not drive them out before you, but they shall be what? Thorns in your side, and their God shall be a snare unto you. I told you when we fail to be obedient unto God, as the Israelites did, we lose things. And verse 2 and 3 of Judges 2 tells us that the first thing that they lost the absence of conflict. Let me explain to you. God, if we look at the history of God's people, that every time God obeyed, told them to do something, God said, I've made provision for you. You're going to overtake all those that come against you. But you must do accordingly to what I command you to do. But the people in this time, they only did halfway. And that is amazing to us. In this time that God is calling us to repent, but yet still only some of us are only going halfway. God is not speaking to a group of people. God is not speaking to a denomination of people. God is speaking to his people. And God is saying us this morning, because of your disobedience, I'm going to cause those same inhabitants that I called you to tell you to drive out, they're going to be a snare. You know what he, in layman terms, guess what he said? These people that I told you to cast out, they're going to aggravate you. They're going to agitate you. In other words, you will never be at peace because of your disobedience. So it says that they lost the absence of conflicts. The second thing is verses 2 and 3 shows me that they lost their conviction of belief. Why? Because when they failed to be obedient to God, to drive out those inhabitants that disrespected God and didn't fear their God, he said they forsook the Lord. In other words, they started serving the inhabitants' God. That's what they lost. They lost their conviction of belief. So in other words, when things started happening, they started to question if the God that they're serving is real. Why? Because they entertained the gods of the people that God told them to drive them out. What I'm saying to you today, church, is we all don't serve the same God. The scripture clearly says that we don't. Another thing that they lost, looking at verse 2 and 3, it says that they lost their desire from separation from sin. In layman terms, they thought they could just serve their God and their other gods. They thought that they could take from their God and then get from the gods of the inhabitants, the gods of their enemies. He says they thought that, look, I can live my life any way I want to live. Let me share something with you, church. When you start serving the gods of this world, serving sin, you will have that same mindset. You start believing that you can just do whatever you want to do and God knows your heart. But that's the problem that we have here today in this text. That when you allow other people's God to influence you, to make you believe that you can do whatever you want to do and live any kind of way and say whatever you want to say and just wild out, as they say, we believe that God is going to be pleased with us. But the scripture tells us, oh no. They turn quickly from the way in which their fathers walked. And how many of us right now in this day and time have turned away from what we know what is right? Because we saw the people that opposed God, we saw them, quote unquote, prospering in their materialistic things. That their God told you that if you have this and you have all these material things, you are blessed. And God says, you are blessed when you are obedient to my command. He's talking to his people. We have to know the difference. We see that God's people failed to drive out the inhabitants of the land as the Lord had commanded them. And God gave them instructions. And God is speaking to his people right now, and he's commanding us. He's giving us instructions. So guess what God did? The verse tells us that God sent an angel to them to reveal to them the consequences of their actions. Amen, church. God sent an angel to his people to reveal the consequences of their actions. God was faithful, and he told them that although they had not followed through on what they were supposed to do, he would not break the covenant with them. You see what it says here in verse 1, the end of verse 1? He said, although you did all that, I will not break my covenant. You know what that is? That's God's mercy, church. That's God's mercy, people. Even though you are being disobedient, he says, I'm not going to break my covenant. That's God's mercy. That being said, he also told them because they did not drive the people out as he had commanded them, the people would be thorns in their sides and their gods would be a snare unto them. Because we failed to be obedient to do the whole thing, the complete thing, there's some things that we failed to do that God has commanded us to cast out. Whatever it may be in your life, because you failed to surrender all to him and you want to keep those things that make you feel good, that's attractive to your five senses, you want to keep those things that God says, those things that I've commanded you to repent, that you're keeping on, it's going to be a snare unto you. You're going to sin, and every time you come before me to ask for forgiveness, that thing that I told you to cast out is going to tell you that I'm not going to forgive you. So what is the right way? What is the right way? I said I'm only going to be here for a moment. What is the right way or the righteous way for God's people to respond when we fail to obey God? What is the right way? What is the righteous way for the people of God? Now, this message is not for those that don't know God. This is not for them. This is not what the Spirit of God told me to speak, commanded me to speak. He told me to speak to the people of God. So what is the right and righteous way for the people of God to respond when we have failed to obey God? Verse 4 says it like this, very plainly and clear. Verse 4, it says, so it was when the angel of the Lord spoke these words, all the children of Israel that the people lifted up their voices and what? No, they lifted up their voices and start singing songs. They lifted up their voices and start singing all these other songs that the world has told you to sing. No, it says here that they lifted up their voices and start giving encouraging words. They lifted up their voices and start singing all these challenges, all these words, and all these feel-good songs. He said, no, they didn't. The people of God lifted up their voices and they repented. They cried out to the Lord God. Now the world will have you singing songs to make you think that your open rebellion is good in God's eyesight. This is not what the word of God says. The word of God says the people of God repented. They wept. See, when the people realize their mistakes, when God's people realize their mistake in this scripture, they cried before the Lord. They cried. They did not do what the world was telling them to do. Like I said before, they didn't go around singing songs to make them feel better. They cried out, they repented. I'm going to share with you a small testimony that happened on Saturday when I was in my quiet time, and I shared this with the body of believers that during my quiet time, the Spirit of God spoke to me, and some of you all received it, and I posted on the church page that God told me to tell his people that these are sensitive times. And these are the times that the people of God have all their families with them in one place, even in the midst of what God is allowing to happen. This is a time where all the families and people of God are together. He said, these are the opportune times for us to share with our children the truth about who God is. The world is not going to do that. He's not holding the world responsible or accountable, for they know not what they do. But he's speaking unto the people of God. He says, this is the time for you to teach your children, to train them up in the way that they should go. These are the times for you to teach your children, your unsaved husband, your unsaved spouse, your unsaved grandmother, aunt, uncle that resides in your house. Tell them the truth about who I am. Remind them of what I've done for my people. But the problem that we have right now is it's so hard. We talked about this during Sunday school. It's so hard for my children and for the people that don't know God, that live within our household, to understand and believe what God has done, because we've done something so detrimental to our generation. And God is going to show us right here what happens when we fail to pass down God's way in our generation. What will happen to the next generation? What would happen to the next generation? I'm not concerned about what's going on right now, because God is the one. When you want to know when this is going to be over? It's going to be over when it's finished. Let's move on. He said, but when we fail to share with this generation of the goodness of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, when we fail to teach our children and train them up about God, when we fail to teach them about Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9, where it says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verse 9, he says, and these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and talk down and tell them when you sit in the house. We in the house, ain't we? We in the house. We can't go anywhere. He said, I'm talking to my people. You shall teach them this truth in your house. When you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up, he said, you shall bind them as signs on your hand, and they shall be a frontlet between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost of your house and on your gates. I'm talking to God's people. But what happens? What happens when we fail to be obedient to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9. I'm talking about God's people. Look at verse 10 of Judges chapter 2. Same book, same chapter, but go down to verse 10 through 15. You want to know what happens when we fail to be obedient to Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 4 through 9? Verses 10 starts like this. It says, when all that generation had gathered to their fathers, in other words, when they had gone on, another generation arose after them who did not what? Know the Lord, nor the work which he had done for Israel. Then the children of Israel did what? Evil in the sight of the Lord, and they served Baal. And they forsook the Lord of their fathers who had brought them out of the land of Egypt, and they followed what? Other gods from among the gods of the people who were what? All around them. And guess what? They not only followed these other gods, the scripture tells me, and they bowed down to them, and they did what? They provoked the Lord to anger. This scripture should tell you that God is not pleased with his people. Openly deny and defy his commandments. I don't care what the world is telling you. I don't care what the enemy is telling you. And all these folks, God is not pleased when his people forsake his commandments. Look at verse 13. He says, they forsook the Lord and served Baal and the Ashtoreth. Verse 14 says, look what happened. And the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. Because of their disobedience, church. It says their God got mad because of what? Because they failed to obey his command. Now, I know that has knocked down some walls in somebody's religion right now. Because we think that the God we serve, our God, Jehovah, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, is pleased when we are disobedient to him. The scripture says, the text says, the law says, no, he's not. He said that the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. And I believe that was a different, that's a different degree of anger. You know how we do in the natural. When we get hot at somebody, do we want to be around them? Do we want to speak to them? We can identify when someone is hot at us, can't we, sister? Because they stop, the relationship has been strained and there is no longer no fellowship. And God is telling us today, he says, I'm hot with my people. Bow down to these gods that I have commanded them to kick out of their house. And you know, when God gets angry with us, there's always some consequences. The scripture says here, so he delivered them. Look what he did. So God delivered his people into the hands of the plunderers who despoiled them. And he sold them into the hands of the enemies all around so that they could no longer stand before their enemies. In layman terms, because the people of God failed to be obedient to their God, God himself sold his own people. Allowed his own people to become slaves to their oppressor. Why? Because they failed to be obedient. Verse 15 says, whenever they went out, the hand of the Lord was against them for calamity, as the Lord has said, and as the Lord has sworn to them, and they were greatly distressed. In other words, they were troubled. They were weary. They were crying out, and they didn't receive an answer. Everything around them was coming down. At one point, the people of God were feared. But because of their disobedience, when they went out for war, God says, guess what? I've turned you over to your own enemy. Now, you may think in your mind, church, you may think in your mind, the people of God, that we're being obedient to God and God is answering us and blessing us in the city and the field. Not when we're in open defiance to his word. Not when we have bowed down to the gods of this age. You know, the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eyes and the pride of life. God is not pleased. He's angry at his people. This was a drastic failure on the part of the first generation of the families as they did not leave a legacy of worship to God for the second generation. I shared with you when we fail to train up our children in the way they should go. And as Deuteronomy says, and these words which I command you today shall be in your heart, you shall teach them, he says, diligently. Y'all know what that means? You keep never stop. He said, you teach them diligently to your children and talk with them. And when you sit in your house and when you walk by the way, he says, let me tell you something. If you love me as much as you say you love me, then you should be able to share this love with those within your own household. Remind your children, your grandchildren, your great-grandchildren what God has done for you. Pass it down to them so there will be hope. But if you fail to pass it down, you're going to have what we have now. It burns me in my heart that there's so many people of God that have given up on our young people. Yes, I'm going to say it. That said they're lost. Well, have you asked yourself this question? Are you to blame? Have we done everything we can? Have we passed down this truth about who God is to the younger generation. God didn't say, wait for them to respond. God didn't say, check it out and see if they're listening or not. God just says, you tell them. It says here that they did not teach nor share the testimonies and the stories of the things God had done for them so that the future generation would have this knowledge to choose to serve God. You ever talk to our young people, those that are broken and those that are hurting, they'll tell you, that's the question, why did you do what you did? What is going on? I can't believe that. You know what our young people are saying, the lost are saying? I had no choice. When we pass down the truth about who God is, we're giving the next generation a choice. The next generation, one generation from Joshua, the scripture tells us in verse 10 of Judges chapter 2, it says one generation, not five generations, but the next generation did not know the Lord and therefore began to worship false gods. Those same gods that the inhabitants of the land who were supposed to be pushed out initially, they served. So we see that the failure of the first generation carried over into a subsequent generation, which caused what? A separation between God and his people. And it says, this failure plagued the people of God for many years. Verses 14 and 15 tells us that God of Israel provoked to anger, and he delivered Israel into the hands of their enemies. Amen.
Amen.
He was so disgusted with their open, defiant, and disobedience for them. For the word of God says that God is a jealous God. And true to the honor of his name, God loved them, and scripture bears out that those that he loved, he would chastise. He punished them for their apostasy, for their falling away, by giving them to their tormentors, who they yielded to like slaves to their masters after they forsook God. Whenever they took the sword in hand and went to do battle, they were as sure to be beaten as they had been so conquerors. In layman terms, those victories that God had allowed us to have because of our obedience to him would turn us to victims, and we would lose the war, and we would lose the battles because we were in open defiance. When God is for you, it is more than the whole world against you. But when God removes his presence, his protection from you, you are like sheep that are led to the slaughter, and sheep, amen, my sister, without a shepherd. The scripture tells us that formerly these enemies could not stand before them, since whenever they went out, the hand of the Lord was with them. And then when they began to defy the commandments of their God, look what happened. When the people of God began to defy God's commandments, their God ceased to favor them. I know we have these songs, and I'm not messing with any other artists. I'm just saying, be careful what you're singing. Because the word of God is telling me something different. God does not favor us. We are giving in and we are lusting after the things of the world and manipulating the people of God by telling the people of God, if you have this and you have that, and if you give more, and if you do all this, God is going to bless you. You are blessed because you are alive today. In other words, God stopped his people's progress of their successes. He would not drive out their enemies anymore. He only allowed them to keep their own ground. And some of us are like that right now, right? I know we're praying, Lord, enlarge my territory. God said, because of your disobedience, you just going to stay where you at right now. I'm just showing you mercy by allowing you to keep the ground that you have right now. Don't you know that's my grace? But now, when they had become heavily involved in idolatry, which was regarded as a breach of the covenant with God of Israel, the war turned directly against the people of God. And they could not any longer stand before their enemies. Let me share some with y'all. God would rather give success to those who had never known him than to give it to those he had chosen but had deserted him. I'm going to say it one more time. God would rather give success to those who had never known him, than to give it to those that he had chosen but had openly defied him. Wherever they went, it might have looked like God himself had turned on them to become their enemy and even fought against them. It was then that the balance of power turned against them. Any enemy might destroy them. Any nation might oppress them. God gave them to the hands of the enemy. God gave his people, because of their disobedience, he gave them, according to the scriptures, to the hand of those that were oppressing them. Not only did he deliver them up, not only did he not deliver them up, he allowed the enemies to overtake them. But you know what God did this for? He did it for a good reason. He said, I did it for a good reason, because I want you to know, my people, not the world, not those that don't know me. He said, I want my people to know that I'm a jealous God. You ever been in with a relationship with someone that's jealous? That you can't go nowhere, you can't, who are you talking to? Why are you talking to that person so long? Just jealous. They're always watching you, and it doesn't make you feel good either. Because when somebody gets jealous, it affects the trust in the relationship. You tend to second guess every move because you know that this person is a jealous person. God is saying today to his people, I'm jealous for you, but I will not spare you. Even his own peculiar people, when they provoked him. Let's go to Judges, the next chapter, chapter 3. And I want us to go to verses 7 and 9, because what I want the people of God to see is a pattern. This is not something new. This is just new to who? Yes, yes. He says, I want you to see the pattern of my people. Because so often we always think, when things come upon us as God's people, that guess what? It's going to change us. Me and my wife in the Sunday school was talking about this morning about this movie that came out. It was titled The Passion of Christ. How many people said that they've seen many people who confess Christ as their Lord and Savior. They weep and they cry, but there was no fruit. Because the movie only dealt with their emotions. But the word of God tells me that it's the Spirit of God that convicts the heart.
Right.
And when the Spirit of God, when there's no conviction, all that crying and all that tear jerking and all that sorrow is only for a season. And God is saying, when you fail to be obedient and when you fail to heed the call and the conviction of my Holy Spirit, I'm going to show you this pattern. Judges chapter 3, verse 7 and 9 says, so the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. They forgot for their Lord, their God, and served Baal and the Asherah. Verse 8 says, therefore, the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel. We see this? You would make me think, and I'm reading from the same text, right? But guess what? I'm reading from the same book, but I'm letting you know he is speaking to another generation. The old and the earlier, we realized that the early generation, the first generation, had gone on. Now he says, here once again, my people are not being obedient to my voice. Verse 8 says, therefore the anger of the Lord was hot against Israel, and he sold them into the hand of Cushan Rishathaim, the king of Mesopotamia. And the children of Israel served Cushan Rishathaim 8 years. When the children of Israel cried out to the Lord, guess what God did? The Lord, verse 9 says, the Lord raised up a deliverer for the children of Israel, who delivered them, Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's younger brother. Look what happened. It says, when the Israelites sinned, God himself, and not their enemy, sold them into the hands of the enemy. And you ask yourself this question. Why did God allow the punishment to come upon his people? Some of us are asking that question right now. Why is God allowing all of this happening to come upon his people? Verse 7 of Judges chapter 3 will tell you. So the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. They forgot the Lord their God, and they served the Baals and the Asherah. But here's the good news. Here's the good news. Verse 9 says that when the children of Israel cried out to the Lord raised up a deliverer from the children of Israel who delivered them, Othniel, the son of Kenaz, Caleb's young brother. It says the God of infinite mercy saw their distress. Let me tell you something, church. God hears our cry. God sees our distress. And guess what God is going to do to us as he did with the other one? He took pity. He's going to have some mercy. Even though they had brought their troubles upon themselves by their own sin and recklessness, amen. He brought them deliverance by the judges he elevated. Even though they deserved what they were getting, God showed mercy. Because you know what he said? I will not forsake my covenant that I made with you. Nevertheless, despite the fact that their trouble was punishment for their sins and the accomplishment of God's word, yet they were eventually saved out of their trouble. What are you saying, Pastor? What are you saying, man of God, to the people of God? When trials and tribulations hit our home, when trials and tribulations hit our city, when trials and tribulations hit our state, hit our country, and hit our world, who do you blame? Far too often, many of us, instead of looking inward and asking, what have I done wrong? Where have I sinned or disobeyed God? We start looking outward and start pointing fingers. I'm talking about the people of God. The world will respond the way the world responds. I'm not speaking to the world today. God is not speaking to the world. He's speaking it to his people. Who are you blaming? You pointing fingers? He said, that's how the world acts. Many people are taught that once anything bad happens to them, it must be the enemy. That's our excuse of not realizing that, guess what? We've disobeyed God. They will blame anyone and everyone instead of themselves. So what causes many of God's people to remain in bondage? God has not stopped speaking to his people. But yet still, we don't see any progress spiritually. Why is it? What hinders God's people from moving forward? The same thing that happened in the Old Testament is happening now. Unbelief and ignorance. We remain in bondage to sin because we fail to believe the promises of God in the scriptures. We don't have a sound relationship with God. We don't have time to study the word of God. So we can't pass down something we don't know. So if we fail to study the word of God and we were challenged to pass down the word of God to the generation behind us, and if we don't study, we'll start passing down heresies and genealogies and fables and things of this nature that don't glorify God. And we'll go around and make this falsehood true. Why? Because we failed our part. So we have more people shouting over things that are material than what God has commanded us to live spiritually. Because we fail to pass down the truth about God's word. So we can't pass down something we don't know ourselves. And we don't make time to commune or speak to God in prayer to the one who has all the answers. You know why, people of God? Because we're too busy. As I said at the beginning, in the opening of this message, we're in a transition. We must get this right, people of God. We cannot remain as we were, and we cannot focus on what has been lost. God is saying, stop living in the past. Today is a new day. He's telling the people of God, he says, hearken unto my voice and harden not your heart. We cannot focus on who will and who won't do it. We can't focus on, as people of God, what this sect of people are going to do and what this sect of people are going to do and what this political people are going to do and what this political. We can't focus on that as people of God. We must focus only on doing the will of God. So I'm asking the people of God today to make a choice. I'm asking you to choose to lay it all on the line. I'm asking the people of God to do what God has been commanding us to do since the beginning of our rebellions toward him. Repent. To repent, people of God, not as a group, not as a congregation, not as a denomination, not as a conference, not as an institution, not as a nationality, not as an ethnicity, not of your wealth, not of your economic status, but he's calling the people of God to repent as a people of God. This is not going to be a popular statement, young man, but I'm going to say it anyway. Man does not have the answer to this crisis. Man will never have the answer to the crisis or any other crisis. But our God does, for he is the answer. I remember as we wrap up a song that my mother used to sing when I was growing up. And I didn't understand it then, but I understand it now. And I'm not a singer, but I heard her sing this song. She says, Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him, there's no other. Jesus is the way. And that's what God is telling us today, that Jesus is the answer.
That's right.
For the world today. Above him, there is no other. Jesus is the way. So we ask the question, Pastor, man of God, servant of God, what must we do? God says, repent. Let's go to Psalm 51, and we're going to be done. Psalm 51 is telling the people of God what to do all over this world. The Psalm of David. And David penned this psalm when Nathan the prophet went to him. After he had did what? Been with Bathsheba. I'm not going to call out Bathsheba. He went to David after David had disobeyed God. And God is saying the same thing to his people today. Psalm 51 should be our cry. Not for the world, but for the people of God. And it reads, have mercy upon me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquities and cleanse me from my sin. People of God, are you hearing? For I acknowledge my transgressions and my sin is always before me. Against you and you only have I sinned and done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak and blameless when you judge. Behold, I was brought forth in iniquity, and in sin my mother conceived me. Behold, you desire truth in my inward parts, and in the hidden part you will make me to know wisdom. Look what he says, purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow. Make me hear joy and gladness, that the bones you have broken may rejoice. People of God, David cried out, hide not your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities. This is what David says, and God is speaking to the people of God all over the world right now. Create in me a clean heart. Oh God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. Do not cast me away from your presence and do not take your Holy Spirit from me. This is where we're at now. Restoration for God's people. God has allowed me to teach this in this body that God is proactive. He's saying in verse 12, restore to me the joy of your salvation and uphold me by your generous spirit. Then I will teach what? Transgressors your ways and sinners shall be what? Converted to whom? To you, not to the pastor, not to the bishop, not to your ministry, not to anything else that you establish, but that the sinners will be converted to Christ Jesus, Yeshua HaMashiach. Verse 14 says, deliver me from the guilt of bloodshed. O God, the God of my salvation, and my tongue shall sing aloud of your righteousness. O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall forth your praise. And you do not desire sacrifice, or else I would give it. You do not delight in burnt offerings. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart. These, O God, you will not despise. In layman terms, guess what David is saying? All those other things that I was commanded to do in the natural, in the physical, to give these sacrifices. He says, you don't demand those anymore. You demand that I come with a sincere heart, with godly sorrow for what I have done against you. Verse 18 says, do good in your good pleasure to Zion. Build the walls of Jerusalem. Then you shall be pleased with the sacrifices of the righteous, with burnt offering and whole burnt offerings. Then they shall offer bulls on your altar. We see in this psalm that true repentance involves a sense of awareness of one's own guilt, sinfulness, and helplessness. Can I say that again? True repentance involves a sense of awareness of one's what? Own guilt. David was not looking at you, young man. David was examining his own heart. David was not looking at what everybody else is doing. David was showing, asking God, Lord, create in me a clean heart. Don't you know repentance starts with you, child of God, you, woman of God, you, man of God, you, people of God. It starts with you. It shows us in the psalm that true repentance takes hold of God's mercy in Christ Jesus. True repentance takes hold of what? God's mercy. We studied that today in Sunday school. About our Lord and our Savior, how he was wounded for our transgressions. True repentance takes hold of the promise that by his stripes we are healed. Not the carnal sickness and the carnal disease that these false people are telling you about, but he's talking about we are healed from sin, and we are healed from death, and we're healed from the power and authority of the grave by what Christ Jesus had accomplished and overthrew on the cross. That's what he's talking about. In this psalm, we also see that true repentance means a change of attitude and action regarding sin. In other words, I know we love to use that God knows my heart. We love that because that gives us to justify our open rebellion. But the word of God is telling us, and when you understand that what you've done, what we've done as a people, God is calling his people to repent, to change their attitude and action regarding sin. In other words, he says we should hate sin. He says, I know the world is hating based upon the color and the content and the character and the education. That's what they do. He said, but my people should hate sin. And not the sin in everybody else's, but the sin that is within yours. For the word of God says, before you take the speck out of your brother's eye, remove the plank that's out of yours. And after you remove that, I will show you how to remove the speck out of your brother's eye. People of God, it starts with us. It's not what the world is doing and what the world is not doing. The world is only responding to what they know. They think that they have the cure, the answer, and everything. But we know that God's people, who God has left here to be a light for him in times of crisis, that if we have not repented, that if we are not obedient, then where is the hope? Where is the help? My last point of Psalm 51 says, when I look at Psalm 51, I see that true repentance not only involves a sense of awareness of one's own guilt, sinfulness, and helplessness, not only that true repentance takes hold of God's mercy and Jesus Christ, not only does true repentance mean a change of attitude and action regarding sin, true repentance results in a radical and persistent pursuing of holy living, walking with God in obedience to his command. In the body of believers here at the city, we said we may not be a perfect church, but we are progressively pursuing perfection. I don't want to stop at not, we're not a perfect church. It gives me a reason to do whatever I want to do and to say whatever I want to say. But I want to progressively pursue perfection. And I do those things by the power and the authority and the will of the Holy Spirit by doing what? Imitating everything that Yahshua HaMashiach demonstrated. I'm pursuing perfection. The focus of Jesus Christ's mission was to call sinners to repentance. Verse Luke 5:32 says, I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. His call of absolute surrender goes out to all people. But unless you repent, you too will all perish. Luke 13 and 5 says, in his farewell to his disciples, Jesus commanded that they take this message of repentance and faith to all nations. Luke 24 and 47 says, he says, repentance involves a complete, listen to this, repentance involves a complete and irreversible change of mind, heart, and action. Repentance recognizes that our sin is offensive to our holy God. To repent means to make it about face. We're in a military town. To make it about face, to make a heart directed turn away from self to God. I know we in the world, where the world is saying, do you be your own God? I know that's what the world is saying, but not God's people, because God has put us in remembrance. Look what I have done for you in the past. I was with you the whole time. If it was up to you to overcome your enemy, you couldn't do it. You would be wiped out. That's why I said that you are my people, and I'm your God, and I'm with you. I'm your deliverer. I'm your protector, and I'm your provider. You can't do this on your own. So it says, it means to take a heart-directed turn away from self to God, from the past to a future ruled by God's command. Acknowledging that the Lord himself reigns over what? Everything. God is saying to his people today, when my people, not the world, when my people repent, I will send a deliverer. God also said it clearly that this repentance through Christ Jesus for what he finished as the last sacrifice, the last for the sin of the world, he says it's for everyone. I know God has called me to speak unto his people, but he told me, son, don't leave those that don't know me out. Mm-hmm. Let them know that John 3:16 through 18 is not only something to familiarize or to remember or to quote, mm-hmm. but to live, to remind them that for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Christ Jesus might be saved. My prayer for God's people is that we would repent, not as a group, not as a denomination, not as a congregation, institution, but as his people. And I believe God's word, that if my people who are called by my name will humble themselves, if they would pray, if they would seek my face, if they would confess their sins, God made a promise to his people. He says, then I, not you, God says, then I would hear from heaven. When my people repent, he said, then I will hear from heaven. And you know who's in heaven with the Father, sitting on the right hand, Christ Jesus, the Holy Spirit. He said, then I will hear from heaven, and I will agree with them. And I will say, because my people have done this, guess what I'll do? I'll hear their prayers, and I'll heal the land. He said, and then I'll be open. My eyes will be open and attentive to the prayers of who? My people. Let us pray. Father God, we thank you for your grace and your mercy, your love, your word, your power this morning, Lord God. We know, Father God, that you have spoken unto your people. We pray and ask, Lord God, and we believe the word will never go out and return unto you void, but it will accomplish what you have set forth to accomplish. I know conviction is happening all over, Lord God. Someone may be asking, what must I do to be saved? What must I do to be a child of God? Word of God clearly states that if we confess our sins, that God is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us of all unrighteousness. So, Father God, the prayer that those who heard the word of God, who believe what the Spirit of God has spoken unto the people of God on this day, will confess, will repent, will cry out, will turn, will change the way they think about who Jesus Christ is and what he has done and where he has overcome and what he has overcome, sin, death, and the grave, and where he's seated and what his purpose is in seated, being seated right next to the Heavenly Father. The Word of God says he's interceding on our behalf. We pray that your Holy Spirit, your Ruach HaKodesh, would move, Lord God, in the hearts who are saying right now, and would take that cry unto the Son of God, and he would present it to the Father by faith and by their confession and their faith in who Christ Jesus is and what he has done. They're saved. I pray that that same soul will seek you, Lord God, will make their mind up to discipline themselves, to study your word, to learn of you, to learn more of you, to learn more about you so they will not be deceived by those who do not know you and those that oppose you. That they will know the truth about who you are, and they will stand on that truth, and realizing that when we stand on your truth, there will be opposition. There will be persecution. There will be people that will fall away. People will call us all kinds of names. But we know that if you're for us, it's more than the whole world against us. So have your way. I pray for this world as a whole, Lord God. As your people are crying out, every nation of people that are crying out today, Lord God, I pray that you would move, Father God, according to your power, your will, your way, that we may experience a true revival. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name we ask it all. Amen. It's offering time. Amen.